An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Nowhere is that more evident than with vaccines. Perhaps the greatest achievement of modern medicine, vaccines have saved countless lives by preventing deadly diseases that once killed millions across the globe. But will the vaccines of the future be the same as those of the past? I'm Dhruv Kular, and this is Trust TV. To help us understand the past, present, and future of vaccines, I'm joined by Ted Schenkelberg, co-founder of the Human Vaccines Project. So Ted, tell us a little bit about the kind of history of vaccines, the way that we traditionally think about developing them, and what we need to do going forward.
So vaccines have been one of the most important public health interventions in human history. Since 1900, they've helped add several decades to human life expectancies, and they've allowed us to really eliminate and conquer many of the diseases that we don't even recognize now that plagued us at the beginning of the 20th century. We believe that if we can understand the system better, diseases like cancer, or diseases like Alzheimer's, or diseases like influenza, we can develop next generation vaccines, next generation therapeutics which harness the immune system against those.
So tell us a little bit about the Human Vaccines Project, how it came to be, and what it's focusing on right now.
The Human Vaccines Project is focused on decoding and understanding how the immune system fights disease. And it's driven by technology. We use systems biology to measure and monitor every part of the immune system in the body. To learn across individuals and across populations what the underlying rules of immunity are. And we apply artificial intelligence and machine learning to parse out those rules.
So we're talking right now in the midst of the coronavirus epidemic, and there's kind of a rush to try to develop a vaccine for that. What lessons can we take from this experience with coronavirus that we can use for the future?
I think there's lessons across the board. There's public health lessons in terms of response. There's public health lessons in terms of rapid diagnostics. But also in product development, I think we have to realize that we need to have thought about these things before they happen. We need to make investments before they happen. So we think there's basic research. We think there's investment. We think there's platform changes that have to change. And there's common sense public health interventions, which probably should have been placed in health systems long before.
So we're talking about really a shift in the way that we think about developing vaccines. Tell me a little bit about the technologies that are being used to do this.
So over the past 10 or 15 years, certainly, there's been a revolution in biomedical technologies. We have sequencing, which has become ubiquitous in every lab, and we can do it for less than $1,000. We can monitor every part of the body from the genomic, single-cell, proteomic level. This is allowing us to see how systems change over time and how systems respond to disease or vaccines. That produces huge amounts of data, and we now have the tools to understand these massive data sets.
So, as a doctor, when I'm speaking with patients, how should I be talking to them about vaccines or what's coming down the pike, or what should patients more generally understand about what is available and what might be available going forward in terms of vaccines?
So first, I think that patients need to know that vaccines are some of the most well-tested, broadly used products in human history, and they've had massive impacts on our health, but also in terms of reducing hospital admissions. I think that we need more investment in targeted areas. I think that in terms of pandemics, we need to have flexible manufacturing capacity so that we suddenly have a surge or a need for 100 million doses that's out there and we don't have to rely so much on the private sector.
What can we do now to make sure we're in a better position going forward?
I mean, I think we have to continue to work closely with the private sector. I think the public sector, by having stable investments and perhaps even public capacity for manufacturing, can help de-risk some of that project and offset some of the cost or the risk for the private sector. But both groups have to work in tandem. And I think we have to have a clear long-term investment both in prevention and infrastructure. So it's there when we need it and we can turn to it when we need it.
Well, it sounds like a very exciting time, Ted. Thank you so much for being with us.
My pleasure. Thank you.